स्टुडंट्स आलेत म्हणजे आपण लागू करतो त्यानंतर चेंज करतो ठीक करतो ना आपण रोज
हो आले आले मग ठीक आहे ठीक
पता चला इसी से कॉल लगा
दिया पूछना जरूरी है
स्टार्ट
कर
एक नंबर चालू करायचं
14 रन झाले सर
बर एक मिनिट थांबला ऑडिओ ऑन हा In this lecture, we will be covering topics ranging from spine anatomy, basics of spine anatomy related to cervical, thoracic and lumbar region, which is different for all three regions, clinical examination of a patient who has sustained a spine injury or is suspected to have a spine injury, radiological evaluation of all these patients, classification systems which are different for cervical, thoracic and lumbar regions, and basic principles of management of these patients. Spine has four curvatures, two of which are in kyphotic orientation and two of which are in lordotic orientation. Cervical and lumbar, these two are in lordotic orientation, while thoracic and sacrum, these two regions are in kyphotic orientation. There are 33 vertebrae in total in human spine, 7 cervical, 12 thoracic, 5 lumbar, 5 sacral vertebrae are fused to form one sacrum, while 4 coccygeal vertebrae are rudimentary and very small. Cervical and lumbar, these two curvatures appear after birth, while thoracic and sacral curvature are present even in utero. So these two are secondary curves. Cervical curve appears once the child starts holding the neck, and lumbar curve appears once the child starts sitting or standing. So cervical and lumbar are secondary or acquired after birth, and thoracic and sacral curves are present at birth. There are 31 pairs of spinal nerves exiting below the said vertebrae, while one C1 nerve exits above the C1 vertebra. There are 8 cervical spinal nerves and 31 in total. Spinal cord, which starts at the cervicomedullary junction, extends usually up to the lower end of the lower border of the L1 vertebra. Below this level, there are only nerve roots, bunch of nerve roots. The main spinal cord has ended and all the nerve roots are there below this. So lumbosacral nerve root plexus is below this, which is called as cauda equina. And junction of these two, that is spinal cord and cauda equina, is called as conus medullaris. Coming to the anatomy of vertebrae in each segment, is totally different. A typical vertebra usually consists of a vertebral body anteriorly. Then there is neural arch, a neural arch formed by two pedicles, each on one side, which connects the lamina to the body. So these two posteriorly are laminae, which are connected to the body by pedicles. So this is a complete neural arch, two lamina posteriorly and two pedicles anterolaterally. Posteriorly, there is a one big process, spinous process. Then there are two lateral processes, which are called as transverse processes, where the muscular attachments are present. And then there are four processes, the two superior articular facets. These are superior articular facets, and two inferior articular facets. So superior articular facet articulates with the inferior articular facet of an upper vertebra, forming a facet joint. So these are synovial joints throughout the spine. formed by superior articular process of an inferior vertebra and inferior articular process of a superior vertebra. Plus, there is a disc which holds two vertebrae anteriorly. So the body in case of lumbar vertebra is what we call as kidney shaped, and the facet joints are around 45 degrees to the horizontal. In thoracic vertebra, if you compare, the body is heart shaped. The body is kidney shaped here, and it is heart shaped in case of a thoracic vertebra. Plus, there are other differences compared to lumbar vertebra. There are facets for rib attachment. Facet transverse costal facet on transverse process for rib attachment, and costal facet and at the lateral surface of the body for rib attachment. Facets, if you look at the orientation of these facets, these are almost vertical. So the facets, superior articular and inferior articular facets, are almost vertical in case of a thoracic spine, restricting the mobility. So thoracic spine is the least mobile part of human spine because of two reasons. One is rib attachments, rib cage makes the reduces the mobility, and two, the articular processes are vertically oriented. So if this joint is vertical, then there is less chance that it will flex or extend. And going to the cervical vertebrae, here there are many differences compared to typical vertebra. The body is smaller, the spinous processes are longer. Many of the times there are bifid spinous processes. Plus, there is one landmark feature. This is one foramen, which is called as foramen transversarium or transverse foramen, which is for vertebral artery. And if you carefully look at the facet joints, they are almost horizontal. So they give maximum mobility. So if you see, the spine has its maximum mobility at cranio-vertebral junction first, then there is lower cervical spine, which have these horizontally oriented facet joints. So if you want to flex or extend your neck, these joints help in that movement. So looking at all three vertebrae at a time, we can see the differences. In case of cervical spine, the spinal canal is really spacious. In thoracic spine, it is minimal. And in lumbar spine, it is again increasing in diameter. So if injury is occurring in thoracic region or near thoracolumbar junction, we'll have higher chances of injury to the neural structures because the spinal canal is having least diameter in the thoracic region. And again, there are differences in the shapes of body. Body is smaller in case of cervical, heart-shaped in case of thoracic, and kidney-shaped in case of lumbar. And spinous process is going downwards in case of a thoracic vertebra. Plus, there are costal facets for rib attachment, and there is foramen transversarium in cervical vertebra. So these are basic anatomic differences of the cervical, thoracic, and lumbar region vertebrae. Then these vertebrae, as we discussed previously, are attached by joints, superior and inferior articular facets. Plus, there are multiple ligaments supporting the spine to bear our body weight. This is in front, attaching at the anterior border of vertebrae, is anterior longitudinal ligament. Posterior longitudinal ligament runs along the posterior border of vertebrae. In between is the intervertebral disc. This one is a ligamentum flavum. Ligamentum flavum runs from one lamina to the other lamina. So from superior inferior surface of superior lamina to the inferior surface of inferior lamina. Then this is the interspinous ligament between two spinous processes, and the last one is supraspinous ligament above the spinous processes. So from front to back is anterior longitudinal ligament, the intervertebral disc. There are posterior longitudinal ligament, this ligamentum flavum. There are interspinous ligament and supraspinous ligament. So all these are helpful in maintaining the stability of spine, and injury to these ligaments is used in classifying the injuries to the spine and formulating treatment accordingly. So this is the very basic concept given by Dennis and others. They have divided spine into three columns: anterior, middle, and posterior. Anterior column includes anterior longitudinal ligament, anterior half of vertebral body, and anterior half of disc. Middle column is posterior half of vertebral body, posterior longitudinal ligament, and posterior column is pedicle, lamina, spinous process, and ligaments associated with it. So the stability of spine is formed by these three columns, and injury to one or multiple columns is related to the stability or instability of a considered injury. So spine fractures most commonly occur because of fall from height. Then the second common reason is road traffic accidents, which are fortunately very less at this present time. Another is hanging, and the rare injuries are penetrating or firearm injuries. Fractures of spine are serious injuries, as they can be associated with damage to spinal cord and or cauda equina. Thoracolumbar junction is the commonest site of spine fractures, and second common site is lower cervical region, that is from C3 to C7 vertebra. Early symptoms of patients with spinal injury are respiratory distress. Respiratory distress is common in patients having higher injuries, like in cervical or higher thoracic level injuries. Pain at the site of injury to the spinal column. Deformity in spinal column is rare to find. Tingling and numbness in upper and or lower limbs, depending on the level of injury. If it is in the cervical spine, the symptoms will be both in upper and lower limbs. If it is in the thoracic or lumbar spine, symptoms will be predominantly in the lower limbs. Loss of power and loss of bladder and bowel sensations. These are the symptoms which should lead us to suspicion of a patient having spine injury. There are two important features which we should be able to understand. One is a spinal shock, and another which is called as neurogenic shock. So spinal shock is transient reflex depression of spinal cord function below the level of injury. So this is a transient phenomenon which usually lasts for 24 to 48 hours. So below the level of injury, the muscles are flaccid, reflexes are absent, and sensation is lost. So spinal shock is a phase in which the spinal cord stops functioning for certain amount of time. After maybe 24 hours or 48 hours of re-examination, we might be able to find the actual neurological problem. Another thing is neurogenic shock, which is different from what we usually see, hypotensive shock, which is because of blood loss. Neurogenic shock is because of disruption of sympathetic outflow from T1 to L2. Because of spinal cord injury, this sympathetic outflow is disrupted, which is leading to hypotension, bradycardia, and hypothermia. Hypotension usually is associated with tachycardia, but in neurogenic shock, hypotension and bradycardia both go hand in hand. Since the sympathetic chain starts at T1, this neurogenic shock is more common in mid-thoracic or higher thoracic spinal injuries. Next is examination. Examination of any trauma patient usually starts with confirming patient's airway, breathing, and circulation. Once you have established that all three things are going fine, you go on to next. Next is you have done the local examination, the tenderness and deformity, as we discussed in previous slides. Next is sensory and motor examination, plus reflexes. And if there is incontinence of bowel or bladder, that suggests a significant neural injury. Sensory and motor examination will go in detail. How do we do it? There is a grading which is called as American Spinal Cord Injury Association grading, ASIA grading, in which they have defined key sensory points right from C2 to S5. So S4, S5, C2 is at the level of neck, and if you observe, S4, S5 is perianal region. So they have graded it 0, absent sensation, 1, impaired sensation, 2, normal sensation, and 3, not testable. So it is graded from 0 to 2, from C2 to S5. So you should check all these dermatomes in the upper limb and lower limb. If the upper limb dermatomes are normal, you can directly go to lower limb dermatomes. So last point to be checked in sensations is anal sensation, if it is present or absent. Next is motor examination. Asia grading has also given key motor examination points, which you examine from C5, C6, C7, C8, T1. For C5, you examine elbow flexors. For C6, wrist extensors. C7, elbow extensors. C8, finger flexors, distal phalanx of middle finger. And T1, finger abductors, little finger. So this is a normal MRC grading for muscle power, which is graded from 0 to 5. 0 is no power. 1 is palpable or visible contraction. 2 is movement eliminating the gravity. 3 is movement against the gravity. 4 is movement against some resistance. And 5 is active movement against full resistance. So upper limb we have discussed from C5 to T1. Similarly, lower limb is from L2 to S1. L2 is hip flexors. L3 is knee extensors. L4 is ankle dorsiflexors. L5 is long toe extensors, and S1 is ankle plantar flexors. Again, there is one special point given to voluntary anal contraction. Like in sensory, they have given point for any anal sensation. In motor, they have given for voluntary anal contraction, which you check with a per-rectal examination. By doing per-rectal examination, you ask patient to contract the external anal sphincter, and if it is present, you mark it as yes. And then there is a whole chart. In this, you do the grading, right, left, upper limb, lower limb. And by this grading, you come to a conclusion of Asia grade A to E. Asia grade E is complete loss of sensory and motor function. Even the sensory or motor function is not preserved in S4 or S5 segments, which we tested. Perianal sensation and voluntary anal contraction is absent. Grade B is sensory. In sensory examination, perianal sensation is present, but there is no motor function, like there is no external anal sphincter contraction. Grade C is incomplete motor function present, but the power graded in all the muscles right from cervical to lumbar region is less than 3. D is the power in muscles is more than 3. Any one power, if it is more than 3, it will be graded as grade D. And grade E is normal sensory and motor function in both upper limb and lower limbs. So what is the importance of examining the perianal sensation and external anal sphincter contraction is because they have defined a complete spinal cord injury and incomplete spinal cord injury. Based on that, so if the lower sacral segments are preserved from the injury, it is called as incomplete spinal cord injury. And if all the sacral segments are also not showing any sensory or motor function, it is called as complete spinal cord injury. So incomplete spinal cord injury is called as sacral sparing. Sacral sparing can be present if there is a perianal sensation, or if there is a rectal tone, or if there is a great toe flexion. Because as we discussed, S1 is responsible for great toe flexion. So from S1 to S5, if any is present, it is called as incomplete spinal cord injury or sacral sparing, which is an important prognostic factor for neurological recovery. Patients with incomplete spinal cord injury will have good prognosis for neurological recovery, while patients with complete spinal cord injury will have a poor prognosis for neurological recovery. Next, once we have finished with the complete motor and sensory examination of a particular patient, we come to investigations. First is basic is X-ray, AP and lateral view of the area affected. Second is CT, which shows the structural damage of individual vertebrae and displacement of bone fragments into the vertebral canal. And MRI, which is a very important investigation nowadays, it will show the status of intervertebral discs, status of ligamentum flavum, status of neural structures, also status of posterior ligamentous complex, which consists of interspinous and supraspinous ligaments. It is MRI is indicated in all the patients with neurological deficits. So patients graded from grade A to grade D in Asia grading will all need to undergo MRI for further evaluation. So types of injuries. This is rather a mechanism of injury than type of injury based on X-ray examination. One is flexion compression injury. So the vertebral body is getting compressed because the flexion force is being applied on the spinal column. Second is direct vertical compression. The vertebral body is getting crumbled because the pressure is being applied directly onto the vertebra, either from above or from below, and the vertebral body is getting crumbled. It is not distracted posteriorly. Third type is flexion destruction. The spine is flexing, but the posterior elements of the spine are getting distracted. If you observe carefully, there is difference between flexion compression and flexion destruction. Flexion destruction injuries are more dangerous because they are involving right from anterior to posterior column. While if you observe flexion compression injuries in the initial grades, only involve the anterior column. Middle and posterior column are good. But in flexion destruction injury, which is also called as chance fracture, there is involvement of anterior, middle and posterior column. And the last, which is the most dangerous of all these three injuries, is flexion rotation leading to fracture dislocation of the spinal column. All three columns are affected, anterior, middle and posterior. Direct injuries, as we discussed, are less common, which are either because of sharp objects or firearm. If you see the X-ray examples of different types of injuries, the first one is a compression fracture, which is involving anterior and maybe middle column. So this is the injury which has better prognosis. Second one is burst fracture. Burst fracture happens because of vertical compression. Vertical compression, fall of heavy weight on the shoulders or on the head, or fall from height, landing directly onto your foot, can lead to these type of fractures, which are called as burst fracture because of vertical compression. Third type is flexion destruction injury, which is called as chance fracture, or which is also called as seat belt injuries. Seat belt injuries happen because the upper half of your body is going anteriorly once the brakes are suddenly applied, while the lower half is remaining attached to the seat because of seat belt. And the last one is fracture dislocation, which has multiple mechanisms. Main mechanism is flexion and rotation of the vertebrae. So these two, flexion destruction and fracture dislocation, have worst prognosis. Compression fractures, if we want to further divide them, they can be divided into type A, which involves fractures of the both the end plates, type B, fracture of the superior end plate, type C, fracture of the inferior end plate of a vertebra, and type D, both the end plates are intact, but the vertebral body has crumbled. So, Dennis 3 model concept is again utilized after we have seen, after we have graded, is it compression, burst, flexion destruction, or fracture dislocation type of injury? We decide about the stability of injury. So any injury involving two or more than two columns of these three column model. So if the anterior and middle column is involved, it is unstable injury. If the middle and posterior column is involved, it is unstable injury. If the anterior and posterior column is involved, it is unstable injury. So unstable injury is involvement of two or more than two of these three column concept given by Dennis. Unstable fracture, why are we dividing the fractures into stable and unstable? because unstable fractures have a higher risk of neurological deterioration or appearance of neurological symptoms which were absent at the time of injury. Next investigation which we discussed is MRI. MRI is of huge importance these days. As you can see on X-ray, we can see a dislocation between C5 and C6 vertebra. But on MRI, we can see the status of intervertebral disc. Sometimes this intervertebral disc gets prolapsed into the spinal canal. We can see the status of spinal cord. Is there any edema inside the spinal cord? Next thing we can see is the status of posterior longitudinal ligament complex. So intraspinous ligament, if we see this intraspinous ligament has high signal intensity. So there is injury in this area also. So right from anterior column, middle column, and posterior column, all three columns are involved in this particular patient. So MRI gives us important clues about the soft tissues, the intervertebral disc, the spinal cord, and the posterior longitudinal ligament complex. Next is CT. CT scan is also done mostly in patients who are planned to go for surgical evaluation, surgical intervention, to evaluate the bony anatomy of a fracture and to plan the surgery. We usually do a CT scan. So spine injuries tend to cluster, as we discussed, at junction of two segments. Thoracolumbar is the most common site of spine fractures. Lower cervical spine is next common site. Further, we would like to go on to the management principles. Detailed management, discussing detailed management is beyond the purview of this lecture. We might discuss it further in the next lectures, but we'll go through the principles of management. So the early management is airway breathing circulation, and then the spine is immobilized until the patient has been resuscitated and other life-threatening injuries have been identified and treated. Immobilization of spine is abandoned only when spinal injury has been excluded by clinical and radiological examination. So patients having respiratory distress, patient having tenderness in the spine, patient having weakness in the upper or lower limbs, all are considered having spinal injury until it is proven by radiological assessment that they are not having spinal injuries. So next thing is medical line of management, use of methylprednisolone. Methylprednisolone bolus dose of 30 mg per kg is given over 3 hours, and then the infusion is given over 24 hours at the rate of 5.4 mg per kg per hour. So infusion is given for 24 hours if the bolus is given within 3 hours of index injury, and infusion is given for 48 hours if the bolus is given within 3 to 8 hours of injury. If patient is arriving after 8 hours to our hospital, there is no benefit of giving methylprednisolone for a particular patient. So this methylprednisolone is beneficial in neurological recovery if it is given within 8 hours of the injury and in these particular doses. Principles of definitive treatment. The objectives of our treatment of a particular patient with spine injury is to preserve neurological function, to stop further deterioration, and if patient is having no neurology, to stop him progressing into neurological compromise, and to minimize a perceived threat of neurological compression. This sentence explains that unstable injuries. So unstable injury is a perceived threat to neurological compression. So injury involving more than two columns is a perceived threat to neurological compression, and to stabilize such a unstable fractures. Last aim is to recreate or maintain normal spinal alignment. So recreating lumbar lordosis or thoracic kyphosis, or for that matter cervical lordosis, is important to prevent long-term complications like pain or long-term neurological deterioration. And the last one would be to rehabilitate a neurologically compromised patient. There are special departments and special hospitals for this last point. This is very important, because patients having grade 3 or grade 4 power, if they are trained, they can even cook for themselves, they can drive a car, there are multiple activities they can do. In military, there are special hospitals to rehabilitate such patients, but in Western and civil developed world, they have rehabilitation hospitals for patients with spinal cord injuries. Conservative management consists of medication for pain relief, bed rest for around 3 to 4 weeks, and use of collar and braces for immobilization of injured area of spine. So these are a few examples. This is a Philadelphia collar, which is used for injuries in cervical spine, which are with our evaluation of radiological and clinical examination, we have said that this patient needs conservative treatment. We will put him on a Philadelphia collar for about 3 to 4 weeks. And there is this big hole which can be utilized for tracheostomy. This is a TLSO brace, thoracolumbosacral orthosis, which can be used for fractures ranging in upper thoracic, middle thoracic to lumbar region for conservative treatment. There are specific indications for going ahead with the surgery. First and foremost is progressive neurological deficit. Patient is admitted to us with grade 4 power, and same evening we find that patient is deteriorating into grade 2 or grade 3 power. That is urgent indication of surgery. Next one would be Cauda equina syndrome, which consists of multiple symptoms like bowel bladder involvement, asymmetrical involvement of both the lower limbs, and this is a surgical emergency. Related would be a conus medullaris syndrome. So Cauda equina and conus medullaris, both are relative surgical emergencies. Unstable spinal column, as we discussed, more than involvement of more than two columns explained by Dennis concept, that is unstable spinal column will be an indication for surgery. Plus MRI signs of likely further neurological deterioration. As we said, all patients with neurological deficit will undergo MRI, and there are specific signs on MRI described in latest classification. If those signs are present, we will take that patient up for surgery. So examples of how we achieve what we have said during our discussion. So this is a lumbar spine. Normally it will be in lordosis, but if you observe carefully, there is a localized kyphosis because of this L3 vertebral fracture. If you see, this is L5, this is sacrum, and this is a L3 vertebra. This is L5, L4, and L3 vertebra. L3 vertebra is fractured. It has displaced into the spinal canal. The nerve roots are compromised, and the spinal alignment, which should have been lordotic, has gone into kyphosis. So by doing surgery, we have recreated a normal lordotic alignment by putting in pedicle screws posteriorly and putting a mesh cage or made up of titanium with bone graft inside anteriorly. So the anterior column height was decreased and posterior column height was increased by injury. What we have done is we have recreated the anterior column height by putting in a cage, and we have reduced the posterior column height with the help of pedicle screws and connecting rods. Similarly, if you see, this is a patient with fracture dislocation. Again, the anterior column height is reduced, which is recreated with a cage, and posterior column height, which was increased, is being reduced with the help of pedicle screw and rods. So this is one type of example of a surgery at thoracolumbar or lumbar region. Then if we go to cervical spine, this is a patient with 2, 3, 4, 5, C4, C5 fracture dislocation, which is confirmed on a CT scan. So this patient has been operated with an anterior cervical plate, carpectomy and placement of iliac crest graft, pulse posterior, lateral mass screw fixation. So if you see, this cervical spine should have been in lordosis. It is in lordotic position till C5. But then these three vertebrae have displaced anteriorly, and there is localized kyphosis here. So by doing surgery, we have achieved a good lordotic position. So neural decompression and achieving the normal alignment of spine is important in surgeries.